Welcome back, CUBE community. This is Black Hat 2025 at the Mandalay Bay in Las Vegas, Nevada. I'm Jackie McGuire, your practice lead and principal analyst for security, your favorite security media host, and I am exceptionally excited today because I am joined by Grant Bourzikas. He is the chief security officer at Cloudflare, and I was able to just write up a report, a summary of the report you released last week, so I'm really excited to talk about it. Welcome, Grant. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having me. It's wonderful to be here, Jackie.
Awesome. So the report you released was about link wrapping, and I think my kind of take on it was the inherent trust in some technologies and then how that trust can be weaponized. So we're going to get into the whole thing, but I think maybe we should start with a really high level. What do you do at Cloudflare? What does Cloudflare do? And then we'll get into the report.
Great. And thanks for having me again. So I'm the chief security officer for Cloudflare. I also manage all of the CloudForce One threat intelligence. And so I think that's a very interesting part of my job to see, you know, 20% of the internet transverses through Cloudflare. So we, you know, that job is key because we get to see all the telemetry across the world. Cloudflare, you know, I think is you know, the largest global kind of security provider in the world, with 20% of the internet traffic coming through us, 250 billion attacks a day we see. And so, you know, we do things from zero trust to web application firewalls, protecting the internet, protecting employees. And then we have this amazing compute platform on the edge, which is amazing, running artificial intelligence and GPUs.
Yeah, I think you're one of the most ubiquitous things on the internet. And you go to a website, you click on something, and you get the little orange spinny, like, we're going to verify you're not a bot, Cloudflare thing. So I'm sure most of our viewers are familiar with it.
Yeah, that's my favorite thing. Somebody will text me once a week of, hey, thanks for securing my online transaction. So
yeah, it makes you feel better.
Yeah.
All right, so this report is really interesting. Let's start with, what is link wrapping?
Yeah, so link wrapping is relatively...
It's not like when you spit a verse about a URL, right? It's like,
I mean,
16 bars on...
Maybe. 16, you know.
Wrapping with a W for anybody who's...
Yeah, you know, link wrapping started many years ago when you had these long URLs that, you know, if you went to Cloudflare /products/zero trust/CASB, like, you don't want to send this big long URL. And so, you know, companies like Bitly, and there's various ones out there, we have a service that does the same thing, that will to make it into a very small URL so you can see it. You don't have to look at this big long thing. It doesn't take up all of your email address. You know, sometimes you'll copy a link and paste it to somebody, and it's, you know, half a page on your email.
Yeah.
And that's what link wrapping is to make that smaller. Somebody else just, you know, translates it to, you know, a shorter URL. That's all it is. Simple.
That's pretty easy. And then there's also a security aspect sometimes to link wrapping, right? So you wrap, at this point, I think it's Proofpoint we're talking about in this report. And so Proofpoint wraps links also kind of to verify the domain, right? So there's almost like a... They make it seem like the link is safer when they wrap it, and usually it is, right?
Yeah, normally when you hear, you know, sign, you know, you just talked about Cloudflare. If you see, you know, our turnstile application that blocks bots, you think, hey, this website is secured from bots,
yeah,
right? And so in this scenario that we wrote the report last week with Proofpoint, is they were wrap linking, that's hard to say.
Yeah.
If you say it 10 times, I don't think I can do
yeah.
it. And then putting their name behind it, but the URL actually was malware or
yeah.
suspicious content.
Yeah, so it's like, you know, trustedlink.qz.whatever, and the person's like, oh, it's a trusted link. I'm going to click on it, right?
Right.
You know, so I always say that the number one currency in security is trust, mm-hmm. right? It's the easiest thing to lose. It's the hardest thing to gain. And it's really interesting in this report because it's an example of how that inherent trust within this service was weaponized against people, because there's an assumptive safety there. Mm-hmm. And I think you see this broadly across security. You know, I did an interview earlier today. We were talking about, you know, a lot of the most common compromises happen through security tools, you know, or through tools you're already using, like living off the LAN and things like that. So how do you think about trust, especially as a chief security officer? And we've both worked in finance, so we've had security jobs there where you're dealing with literally people's livelihoods mm-hmm. and retirement. Like, how do you think about trust in security?
I think trust in security is the most important thing you have. You know, one of the things I think is important, you know, I am the CISO, but I also talk to a lot of customers. And I think it's important that they trust the organization, right? Like, they trust me.
Yeah.
They trust me to protect Cloudflare. They trust Matthew and our founder to make the right business decisions around what we're doing. And I think, you know, I've always said for years, I want to do business with people that I trust. Mm-hmm. And whether it's a name, a brand, but often it's people,
yeah,
right? When you come down to it, like who's behind that has that issue or who is that I can trust? And sometimes, you know, we've lived in the Zoom world and the Teams world and everybody's web conferencing. And like, I did it today. I met somebody, I'm like, I didn't even, like, I should have known who you were, but I didn't actually know who you were because I've seen you 50 times on Zoom, but I didn't actually recognize you as a person. And so you end up, and instantly you trust that person just a little more, right? And so I think when you get into security companies and what we do, it's important to trust your inputs. It's important to trust your network. It's important to trust the partners and vendors you choose to do work with.
Yeah. So how do you preserve trust as a CISO?
I think you just, maybe a story. And so, you know, we had this incident Thanksgiving Day of 2024 where we had an incident. And we wrote a 12-page blog. I was not legally obligated to do anything. You know, it was something that's happened to me in every job I've ever been at. Mm-hmm. Every CISO I've ever talked to has had this problem, but nobody's disclosed it. Mm-hmm. And I think from a trust, we went out and said, here's what happened. Here is all of the mechanism. Here's the timeline. Here's the IOCs. Here's what we do. Now, a few people, probably 1% of people, look, Cloudflare had an issue. And I said, no, you missed the point. Like, we are transparent and you can trust me. If I'm telling you the truth on this, I'm telling, like, of something that no organization wants to disclose, then you should be able to trust us as an organization. And this is something that from the beginning of Cloudflare, you know, sometimes people say we're a blogging company that had to find some sort of technology to do.
Content company with security services.
We love to blog. We love to write these detailed things. And if you know we're writing that, then we're going to write everything, whether it's good or bad, we're going to write about it. But you don't see that. And I always think, and the hardest thing, if anybody ever, I just remember getting down on the computer and saying, how am I going to write? Like, we had this incident, somebody logged in, we fixed it, it's good. Mm-hmm. No, like this isn't Cloudflare, like, and details, and it's true, right? We went through it, and then you had a lot of people that came to me. I probably talked to almost 100 companies wanting to understand lessons learned. What do you do? That just instituted trust, not with me, but with Cloudflare and our customers, and we saw a lot of big contracts of just coming to us of, if you say that, then we trust you to do the business, because how do you know you can trust an organization if they're, you know, if they're telling the truth or not telling the truth? And I think that's such a big piece of telling the truth, being transparent, being open, being honest.
I don't have any negative associations with Cloudflare. Mm-hmm. And I think that's probably a big part of it. So I briefed with a company a couple months ago, very large company, and they asked me, you know, what my general impression, and I said, you know, my reputation as an analyst is the person who will tell you there's spinach in your teeth. So I'm going to tell you honestly, like, the biggest things I remember about you from the last year is that you had multiple CVEs and vulnerabilities that were hanging around for days and days and days on forums before you acknowledged them. And I think you probably are underestimating how much that impacted people's perception of you and of their ability to trust you, and how many CISOs I've talked to that urged them to seek an alternative because they couldn't trust you to be transparent. Yeah. And that is a huge deal.
Yeah, and you know, this is something I talked to, you know, having been in banking most of my career, where I couldn't really, actually, I was telling this before this, like, I can't really tell you my feelings in that world.
Now I wasn't even allowed to have a LinkedIn when I was a stockbroker. Like, we literally, because everything you put on LinkedIn is technically marketing material and has to go through compliance and all of that. Like, I wasn't even allowed to have social media, much less opinions.
Yeah. You're right. And I think even when you get into TLP Red, and like, I've been very passionate because I was also part of the HTTP2 vulnerability that was this very secretive thing that was, I mean, I think if we wouldn't have drove this with a few other organizations, it would have turned into something bad, but we had to get the information out. And so, you know, a lot of people are preserving that information, holding that, using it to my advantage. And as a CISO, I've been a CISO for over 20 years. would infuriate me because you know something you're not telling me that can get me breached because you're afraid of standing up.
I
think that's, or doing the right thing. And it's not doing the right thing for myself. It's doing the right thing for all of us, right? We always talk about knowledge sharing and public partner, private, partnership. And we don't always do that. And I think the thing that's been interesting here is, trust me, if there's a problem, every cloud provider has abuse on the platform, but it's if you call, if you know the people, if you follow the process, it gets fixed. And I think, it's if you ask me to do something, I do it. And I think this is this trust thing of you have to do business with that organization because eventually, maybe not today, maybe not tomorrow, maybe not in a year, there will be a problem you have with that vendor of non-performance or, poor quality. And I think when you go to it, it's still who do you trust in the organization? Do they have your best interest in mind? And I think it's very valuable to understand that.
Yeah, so my wonderful strategist, Erica, who I work with, who kind of keeps me from spinning off the rails and keeps all my customers happy, one of the most common things I say when I get off the call with someone, if it's someone I like, who's in the community, I'm like, they get it. Like, that is the highest compliment I can pay somebody after getting off a security briefing with them is I'm like, they get it. And what I mean by that is they're in the community because I've unfortunately burned some bridges and friendships by disclosing things to people who needed to know about them that other people were not going to disclose. Mm-hmm. And in some of the communities we're both parts of, that is one of the, that's table stakes for joining that community is, we understand that there are, there are definitely layers of confidentiality and sensitivity of information, but we are all on the same side and we are all fighting a very common adversary. And if you don't communicate, if you don't share information, if you everything is a PR spin and a press release and a, some massaged thing, it's like people can see through that. Mm-hmm. And you can tell the CEOs, the CSOs, the CISOs who have actually sat in the seat because they get it. And when you're like, it makes you mad, I'm like, yes, same. Like, and I think it's, for our families who don't work in this, when we get really, I don't know if you have this experience, but my husband, I'll get so worked up about something. Be like, can you believe this zero day was out there? They didn't tell anybody. And he's just like, what is this a big, I'm like, you don't get it. But that's it. So I really appreciate that perspective. So what do you have going on at Black Hat? What's your favorite events? What do you have going on yourself?
Of course, the Cloudflare events are the best event in the world.
Go visit the Cloudflare booth.
You know what I enjoy at Black Hat is just running into people. And on the way up here, a person approached me. He worked with me when I was at Scottrade in 2005. I don't think I've seen him in 20 years. And just bumping into him for 30 seconds, seeing him. And then I was walking out and ran into another person. What's interesting is just, I would say I'm probably the traditional CISO that has had one too many CISO jobs. I think 7 CISO jobs in 20 years, a little over 20 years. So you're kind of that average of 3 years. I've had a lot of people. I have a lot of people follow me. Mm-hmm. I have a lot of people that, both of these individuals are great people, but, you move on and they move on and you don't see them and then you pop into them. And I think doing that or seeing somebody in a booth or just having those side conversations are, they're just great. And I think that's one of the things. I also, I see some of my own vendors, which is always good to see vendors and talk to people and talk to the CEOs about what's going on. But I also enjoy, I've probably had 5 or 6 customers that want to talk to me and they usually, it's always like, well, what do they want to talk to you about? I'm like, I don't know. Like, why do they want to talk to me? Like,
because you've had so many CISO jobs and you actually know because you get it. That's why they want to talk to you because they can tell you get it.
And it's, they're always, some can be like, hey, what's your perspective on X? Like, there's a big bank that I met with a CISO and she's like, I want to meet with you every quarter. I want to know what's in your head, mm-hmm. what you're seeing in the threat landscape, and just have a sounding board. And why me? Right? Like, I'm just Grant. Yeah. But I think these are things that you see or, there's been meetings where people will consult into me. But here, it's good to meet new CISOs Some CISOs have been around a long time that I happen to know, or people that are first-time CISOs and trying to think about best of breed versus how you use Cloudflare. And so I think they're good. And we had a call today, and the sales team was there, and then they left, and then he came back. And he started asking me more. I'm like, well, I thought you were done with this. Like, yeah. He's like, no, you were in the banking industry. I'm in the bank. Like, I'm just, I'm a British bank. You worked for the British bank. Like, oh, well, I'm happy to just chit chat. And I think those things are authentic, right? And like,
it also renews my faith in humanity. Mm-hmm. To be honest, I come RSA. This, like, there are a handful of security conferences that I walk away from, and I'm like, okay, we're all still on the same team. We're all still moving towards the same objective. Like, the world seems like chaotic and adversarial, but when I come into these rooms, I'm like, the people doing the important work are all still on the same team, and that's what's important.
Yeah, because I think sometimes, I the community, I think, can be a little competitive and a little, why has that person got the job, or why did I get this job? But I think you're like, we're all on the same page. It goes back to the same thing, it's trust, right? Like, are you being open and transparent, and are we collaborating together? And I think that just, to me, is I've got, I did a call with some interns at Cloudflare, and I said, my first CISO job was in 2003, and I was like, was anybody born in 2003? And never should I have ever done that. And not a single person on the call was born before 2003. And I'm like, oh, I'm old.
Yeah.
Like, when did that happen? I mean, I still look good, but
it happens to the, same. It happens to the best of us, but I wish we had more time. Unfortunately, we don't. Grant, I really appreciate you taking the time. I reached out. I really wanted to talk to you. This report's amazing. I love Cloudflare. So thank you for taking time out of your Black Hat experience to come talk to me today.
Well, thanks, Jackie. Enjoyed it. Have me come back. This was wonderful.
Yeah, I would love to. All right, and everybody else, CUBE community, stay tuned. We have lots more coverage coming from Black Hat 2025 at the Mandalay Bay in Las Vegas. We have great guests and a whole bunch of awesome information. So come back, and we'll be right back with you.